Hello everyone, welcome in Preventing Data Loss with Microsoft Purview, a practical guide webinar. My name is Saurabh Srivastava and I am conducting this webinar today. So thank you so much for joining this webinar, and I can see we have lots of participants here. I'm very glad to see you all here. So once again, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. In a different time zone, maybe you are visiting. All right, so we will start with this one. What we have, we'll discuss here what we have in data loss prevention. So let me introduce myself before starting this webinar. My name is Saurabh Srivastava, and currently I'm working in Koenig Solutions as technical lead. My main focus area is mainly related to Microsoft technologies. And I'm handling almost all Microsoft technologies here in Koenig Solutions. I have more than 16 years of experience in production and in corporate deliveries, corporate trainings. And throughout this year, I have worked with different kind of Microsoft products. So if you talk about my Microsoft related experience, so here we have, I can say I have started with the cloud, Microsoft 365, Office 365 in very early days when it was somewhere around in 2012. I have very good experience in Microsoft security, privacy, and compliance, including Microsoft communication, collaboration, messaging products. Also, I have worked with System Center products as well. So these are different kind of products I have in my profile. So now let's go for what we have in today's agenda. We'll discuss about what we're going to cover. So today we are going to learn, first we discuss about what we have in information protection. What is information protection in Microsoft 365? Then we discuss about what we have in DLP, in data loss prevention. What is DLP? How we can use it, this to protect my sensitive informations. Next topic we cover, how to configure and test custom DLP policy. How to create custom DLP policy, what different kind of components are involved in this, we'll discuss about. And in the last, we'll discuss about what we have in Microsoft Purview extension, if you want to extend the DLP capabilities. So these are four different kind of main topics that we cover today. So let's start with what we have in introduction to information protection here. So first of all, introduction to information protection. Let's see what we have in this. So when we talk about information protection, in Microsoft 365, we have different kind of features and services that we can use to protect my information. But information protection journey starts with the first thing, that is know your data. What kind of sensitive information you have in your organization? This is the first stage we have to identify. And then after we move to the other different kind of stages. So first of all, know your data. In this stage, we deal with data classification. We classify data. What kind of data we have in our organization that is sensitive. Some data would be secret data, some data would be highly confidential data. So for all these, we have data classification options available in Microsoft 365. Once you know about your data, what kind of data you have in general conditions, what data you have in secret conditions, then we move to the next stage, that is protect your data. Here, we deal with encryptions, how we can configure encryptions to my data, how we can control access to my data. Can we add visual marking to my data, especially for secret, confidential, or any kind of important data? These all things come under protect your data. also we have for this, if you talk about Microsoft 365, we have information protection capabilities where we create a label. Basically, we can say it's a sensitivity label that we create, and we configure encryption in that, we configure access control, visual marking. These all things we configure there under information protection. Once my data is protected, I have to think about how we can prevent data loss, any kind of risky behavior from user side or from admin side, or maybe any kind of oversharing or sharing kind of capabilities, sharing kind of, you know, activities you are going to perform. I want to prevent any kind of sensitive information that is going to be shared by mistake internally or externally. So for these kind of situations where I'm seeing oversharing of sensitive information, I can use prevent data loss techniques or prevent data loss options in Microsoft 365. Here we have data loss prevention. DLP comes under this. And the next stage, that for how long I want to keep my data in my organization. So here we go to the next stage, that is govern your data, data governance. In data governance, we decide for how long I want to keep my data with me. And here we have different kind of options available in Microsoft 365. We have retention. We can use retention label and retention label policies. We have record management. So these all different things comes under data governance. These are four main stages that we generally see when we are going to deal with data. Starting with knowing your data, protecting your data, data loss prevention, and data governance. Today we are going to talk about what we have in prevent data loss, what comes under in data loss prevention. Now before going for this DLP, let me show you if you are going to open Microsoft 365 admin portal. And from there you have to move to Microsoft Purview compliance portal, because all these are related to Microsoft Purview compliance. So where you can find these options. Maybe if you're interested to go for all these stages, from where you can configure, you can control these different kind of options. Let me show you. Let me share my another screen. All right. So here, this is my Microsoft Purview compliance portal. And this Purview compliance portal gives you all these four stages options that you can configure, you can control. The first is know your data, that goes under data classification. You configure these options from this place, data classification here. We have different options. We can configure sensitive information types. We can configure trainable classifier. We can configure exact data match. These are different options coming under classifiers. Let's wait for this. This is still being refreshed. Let me do one thing. Let me refresh this page once. Okay, here it is. So we have trainable classifier. Trainable classifier is a kind of data classification option that we use, and we have lots of built-in options here from Microsoft that we use for classifying my data. Apart from this, we have sensitive info types. We have 324 sensitive info type already available from Microsoft that we use for classifying my data. There are lots of things. We have different kind of built-in components, different sensitive informations from different countries, from different kind of services and features. We have these all things, these all patterns are already there in the sensitive info types that we can use for data classification. we use these classification in DLP policies as well. Apart from this, we have EDM classifier. EDM stands for exact data match. Exact data match is a part of, you can say, sense to info type. But here, if you have any kind of database, CSV file with definite information, so you can use EDM classifier here. So this comes under data classification. And this is the first stage that classify your data. And then after, we go for information protection. That is protect your data stage. To protect your data, we go to this information protection tab, information protection option here. And this information protection option gives you sensitivity label and these kind of configurations where you can encrypt data, control access, and also if you are willing to configure some kind of visual marking, so you can use this. This is the second stage that what we see in managing my data in Microsoft 365, especially for protecting. Then after, we see how we can prevent data loss using DLP option, data loss prevention. DLP comes here, where we have policies, we have to configure different kind of settings, we have to configure sensitive information types, so DLP can automatically detect what kind of sensitive information types you're going to send, and this will be shared with, basically this will be stopping sharing or going to protect your information in your organization here. And last stage is govern your data, data governance. Data governance comes under data lifecycle management here. And here we configure, let's wait for this. We configure retention policies. We configure retention label. We configure retention label policies. These are different things that what we see if you're going for the last stage, that is data lifecycle management. So these are four main stages that we see. And today we'll discuss about data loss prevention here. Now, apart from this, if you talk about where e-discovery comes in this design, where information, basically insider risk management or information barrier policy, where all these all comes in this kind of stages. So basically these are not coming directly in data protection or information protection stages, but these are other options that we can use for different kind of functionalities and purpose. So coming back to what we have in my slide. So here we are talking about know your data that comes under data classification, protect your data that comes under information protection, DLP, data loss prevention, and govern your data. Here we use retention, archiving, record management, and these options. Now let's move what we have in the next. Here we talk about overview of DLP, data loss prevention. So in DLP, what we have, data loss prevention comes with policy configurations. We have to configure policies based on what different kind of data I want to prevent. And these policies we apply to different places, to different locations in Microsoft 365. For example, I want, if my organization user, if they are going to share any kind of sensitive information, doesn't matter they are using email, SharePoint, OneDrive, Teams, or these kind of places they are using to share data, I want to prevent this information that includes credit card information in any way. How I can do this? I can configure data loss prevention policy for this. So DLP policy can give you this kind of capability where you can decide what kind of sensitive information types you want to prevent, what kind of action you want to take, what kind of control you want to configure. If any user, if anybody in your organization is going to send any kind of or share any kind of data information. So in DLP, what we see, so we can decide where to protect the content. You need to select locations where you want to apply the policy, and then when and how to protect the content. So for when and how to protect the content, we have to configure conditions and action. In which condition I want to apply the DLP policy? If there is any kind of matching pattern, or if we have any kind of other different combinations. So we use locations and rule where we configure conditions and action to create policy. And these policies, if you have selected the right location, these policies works very well. This policy is going to work, any policy like credit card policy or any policy that you created, this work very well, because whenever you are going to try any attempt to share, to send email, this will check DLP policy implementations already in organization, and whatever the policy we have, based on that, this will be preventing the sharing options. So how this looks like from a kind of end user perspective, let me show you that first, how DLP is going to prevent your data, how much DLP is powerful. Let me show you that demo first, and then after I'll come back to this place and I'll discuss about how to create the policies. So I have a demo environment. Let me switch back to that demo environment. Here, in this demo environment, if I go to DLP and click on policies, you can see here, we have different kind of policies in this. Generally, when you are going to create a new tenant environment, in new tenant, you see default Office 365 DLP policy. You can also see default policy for Teams and default policy for devices. These are default policy that we generally see. But here you can see in my this trial tenant, I have two other policies already there. US financial data and general data protection regulation that comes under GDPR. So these policies we have already available in this for demonstration. So how this looks like, let me show you. If I open Outlook, let me show you how this looks like. All right, so here, if I go for new email, in this new email, suppose I'm going to send one email to one of my user, Alex. And here I'm just going to type some subject name, for example, data. Hi, Alex. And I'm going to add some information here, for example, get the data listed below as requested. Now, what is data? Data is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 FA. As soon as I'm going to add this, within 10 to 20 seconds, I'll get a kind of mail tip on the top that this belongs to a company's organization data, and this comes under kind of violation. So a kind of mail tip you can see here. Your email message conflicts with a policy in your organization. Okay, let me continue this message, admin. Now, if I would like to send this, what happens? If I click on send, this says send blocked. You can't send this message. Because of DLP policy, this is blocked. The question is, what this DLP policy is? Let me show you. So right now I cannot send it. Is very clear. Let me discard this message, for example. And this time I go for new email once again. I send this message to Alex user once again. Subject line is data. And here what I'll do, because I have already copied what I have composed in my previous email, I'll simply paste. And as quickly as possible, I'll click on send before getting this mail tip. Because when we get mail tip, this send will be blocked. And if I paste the data and simply click send in the next second, I will be able to send. But even in this situation, DLP will block your message. Doesn't matter how quick you are, DLP will block your message. Let me show you. Paste and send. You can see a message received. I received a message in my inbox. If I open this, it says the data email is blocked. If I click here, I can see the actual message. And it says information that what you are sharing, it's EU national identification number. It's matched with EU TIN number. Now, so this TIN number, this you can say is a TIN number, and here the data is blocked. Now, doesn't matter what you are going to do, definitely this will be blocked. What if I go to and try to share the same information in OneDrive? So in OneDrive, you will see similar kind of experience. If I go to, for example, in OneDrive, this is my OneDrive. And here, let me add a new Word document. And let me add some data, like, for example, data I'm going to add. And simply, let me add this keyword. Keyword is sufficient. I'll just give an example. This is the keyword that what we have. Let me add this many times. I added this keyword in this document many times. And let me change this data name is, document name is DLP test. Saved. And if I basically just a second, I believe you guys are not able to see that part. Just a second. Because it's I open in a different one. That's why. So I believe you can see it now. So I was composing this document, and this document is I'm adding some information here many times, and I have saved this as DLP test. This will be saved in my OneDrive, and let me show you how this is going to protect this one, because this is going to contain this EU TIN number. So in this case, what will happen if I go back to my OneDrive once again? So right now you can see we have DLP test document very newly created. So here, if you click on share and click on settings tab, you see all the setting options are on. You can share this document to anyone, people in Contoso. Contoso is the trial tenant here in this trial environment. You can share this to only people in existing access, people you choose. These are different options that we see. But the question is, because I am, you know, I have already added the UT number in DLP test document, if I will be able to share this document or not to these places? Answer is no. When you try to share, this will block the sharing. But within some time, within 1 minute, this will be presenting a kind of, let me refresh this page once, this kind of restricted icon. And now if I click on share, you notice all other sharing is blocked. Only people with existing access, only they can access it. And this is happening because of we have one default policy, default in the sense a policy in demo environment, that is GDPR, and that GDPR DLP policy is blocking the content that comes under EU TIN number everywhere. And I have received email as well for this. So if I show you what email I have received, you can see here, another email I have received that is related to DLP test, that was the document in OneDrive, is blocked. So you can see, you can open this item if you want. Let me open the item here. And this is the DLP test, what I'm going to say. And the issue is, this is related to EU TIN number. That's why this is blocked. So you can see here, this says it's EU TIN number, and this is blocked because of this. So this gives you this level of control. But can I get the same thing in Teams? Let me open Teams application here. And open Teams. Now in this Teams, let me go for a new chat. I'll send message to Alex. Alex is one of the user in this trial tenant. And let me send message, hi Alex. Sending the message 1234567FA. This is EUTIN number. This message will not be blocked. But ideally this should be. So now here the catch is, the policy we have in our this trial environment, that policy is not configured with the scope as Teams. The GDPR policy is only holding a scope related to Exchange, SharePoint, and OneDrive. That's why we are seeing a UT number is being blocked everywhere in this Exchange, SharePoint, or OneDrive. It doesn't matter what you're going to do there. But this will not be blocked in Teams because we don't have Team under the scope. Let me show you how you can verify this. So if I go back to my DLP policy page, here you can see the GDPR policy. Let me open it. I will edit this policy. Still loading the page. Let's wait for this. All right, so this is still taking time, just a second. All right, so here you can see, name your DLP policy. So basically this is a DLP policy that I'm opening for editing, and I want to show you where this policy is applicable. So if I click on next, click next, you can see the locations are Exchange, SharePoint, and OneDrive. So to all these places, if you use EUTIN number format, this is blocking very well, but not working for Teams. But options are, if I want to modify this existing as well, I can simply click this location, click next. Next, I'm happy with all the other options, and submit. Now what will happen within around 10 to 15 minutes when this policy will be properly applied and this will be working, you can go back to Teams and you can check again if this is going to work or not, if this is blocking the messages in Teams or not. So this is a great thing that you can create different kind of policies related to different kind of sensitive information in your organization. So for now, this policy will take some time when we will be able to test this again in Teams. So meanwhile, we'll go back to slides and we'll see what other discussions we have in this. Some more understanding around this DLP options. So I'll go back to my slides once again. All right, so here. So what is DLP? Now you know what DLP can do. DLP can prevent your data sharing. Doesn't matter you are using email, SharePoint, OneDrive, Teams, or any other place what we have in DLP, we can prevent our data sharing. So here, we can configure locations, conditions, and actions. What I want to configure in my this kind of DLP configurations. And this is very important. If by chance you are going to configure wrong scope, wrong conditions, wrong actions, DLP policy will not work as expected. But it's always recommended whenever you are going to create DLP policy in your organization, always test DLP policy in test environment. And once you are satisfied that what kind of result you are expecting, you are getting the same, then you should go for enabling the DLP policy for the entire organization. So definitely you can prevent sensitive information, laws. There are lots of information, lots of sensitive info types you have in Microsoft 365 that we can add in our DLP policy. How to add, how to create a policy, I'll show you. But before this, when you go to DLP policy, we have two options, especially that comes under data classification. One is Content Explorer, and the second is Activity Explorer. These two options are very helpful. Content Explorer, this basically scans entire organization's data, gives information that in your organization data, to which all places we information already there. So accordingly, you can plan if you want to create DLP policies or not. For example, in your organization, you have 10,000 documents. And out of 10,000, you have maybe 10 documents where you have credit card information mentioned. Are you going to check all these documents manually one by one, that where you have credit card? No. So Content Explorer gives you this information based on what different sensitive information types we have already there in data classification. This gives you these matched places information that where we have credit card informations, 10 times or 10 documents we have 100 documents for financial data. Maybe we have 2 documents with the medical informations. We have 3 documents where we have any kind of maybe bank account numbers. So these kind of matching patterns you can already see in Content Explorer. And accordingly, you can plan if you want to enable DLP policies or not, you want to create DLP policies or not. Then in next, Activity Explorer gives you information about what different kind of sensitive informations you have in your organization and what kind of activity has been taken. If labels are applied, if DLP policies are going to be matched with that, if any kind of DLP policy has blocked anything, these all things comes under Activity Explorer. So when I'll go back to my demo account, I'll show you from where you can check these options. Now the next thing is how to create a custom policy. Creating a custom policy, creating your own policy related to your organization's security and compliance is very important. And we can create policy for different situations, for different sensitive information that I want to prevent. So how we create it, let's talk about. First, I'll show you the demo, then I'll come back to the slides. So whatever we have in the slides, that will be very clear to you. Let me go back to my trial tenant once again. So here, the objective is, let's create a new policy in this. I'll go for create policy. Now in this first page, you see different kind of templates. Let's wait for this, it's still in the loading option. You can see different templates: enhanced, financial, medical and health, privacy and custom. These options, enhanced, financial, medical and health, privacy, these all are representing sensitive info type that what we see in data classification tab. We have there 324 different kind of built-in options, built-in sensitive info type already there that we can use. So these all are categorized in these 4 categories. For example, if you click on financial, you see Australia finance data, Canada financial data, France financial data. So if you are creating policy where your target is to prevent these kind of data, you can select these kind of templates without any second thought. But what if I say, can you create a policy where I want to include France, Germany, and Japan, these all 3 things together. So you cannot do this right now here using these options. Like if you're going to select the template, you can select only 1 template at a time. But another option is you can go to enhanced. Enhanced is a combination of many different templates together. For example, if you go for financial data once again, in financial, you can see we have UK financial data. We have maybe different kind of other, especially for US financial data, you can see some informations we have. But this is not going to include any kind of PIN number or any kind of other informational things. Or maybe if I go for privacy apps, in privacy, if we go for, you know, UK Data Protection Act, what is going to include SWIFT code, national insurance number. So these are separate things. If you go to enhanced, enhanced is a combination of many things together. Suppose if I'm going to click on GDPR enhanced, you see in GDPR enhanced, this is going to include all these informations, different kind of European countries, physical address, social security number, national ID number, and many others. We have tax identification number, driving license number, lots of things we can see here in this. So you can decide, you can go with this template as well if you like to. Else, if you want to combine multiple sensitive info together, click on custom and create your own custom policy. So click on custom policy. We'll click next. I can type the name, example test DLP policy. And description, whatever you like to add, is up to you. We'll go to the next. Here we get this option at assign admin units. Admin units are basically for the, you can say, some kind of management. So what we have in this management, we can configure, we can control different kind of management related to user level, device level, and group level for better control. So we are not going to use this here, because we are focusing only on the DLP things. So I'll skip this part, click next. Now here you can select where you want to apply DLP policy in entire Microsoft 365 environment. By default, Exchange, SharePoint, OneDrive, Teams, devices. Devices means your Windows devices, your corporate devices. Instances, this represents Microsoft Defender for Cloud Apps. This is representing Defender for Cloud Apps. So if you are using Microsoft applications and any kind of sensitive information are going to be shared inside that, this can prevent in these places as well. On-premise repository, for example, you have lots of sensitive information in your on-prem place, in your on-premises file server, or in maybe you have local SharePoint server, or if you have any kind of databases as well. There you have lots of sensitive information. So is this possible to protect that data? Answer is yes. We should select on-prem repositories here. And for this, we install a scanner in on-prem. That scanner gets connected to this DLP policy, getting registered with this. And then after this, provide you protection for on-prem repositories as well. In on-prem, when you install that scanner, you have to provide access rights to that scanner for your file server, for your SharePoint, for your database. That is a kind of, you know, altogether different setup. But the possibilities are there. You can protect your on-prem repositories as well using this DLP policy in cloud. And apart from that, you can go for Fabric and Power BI workspaces. Microsoft Fabric and Power BI is a very easy place where you can share sensitive information. You, especially for Power BI, you visualize data in different formats and you can use different data sources. In that data sources, we may have lots of sensitive information. So in that case, if in case you are concerned about that sensitive information should not be shared by any chance in this Power BI and Fabric place, you can select this option as well. But it's not by default selected, because as soon as I select this one here, all other will be automatically removed. So challenge is, you cannot create policy, a single policy, to include all these other places and Microsoft Fabric and Power BI together. You can create two different policies, one for Fabric and Power BI, and another policy for all these other options. Right now I'm selecting these four options. I'm not going for all other things, because for this you should have different kind of other requirements. These are pure Microsoft 365 places. So I'm going to select these four here. And notice, here selecting all groups, all sites, all users, all groups and users here in this. In case, if you say, okay, I'm not interested to go for all groups. If you have any option to go for specific, answer is yes. You can go click on edit options here. Maybe if you have any exceptions in your mind, you want to include or exclude someone, you can go for edit options here. Right now I'm selecting all, click next. Here we have to configure rule. That rule defines condition and action. in which condition this policy will be applicable. So we go for this customize option, click next, create rule. And here we have six different options that we have to configure one by one. Condition, action, user notification, user override, incident report, and additional options. Let me show you what are different options here in this. So I can create DLP rule, DLP rule one. This is something I would like to remind you. In DLP policy, we need to create DLP rule because rule defines condition and access. So I'm creating a DLP rule here. I'll go to condition, and under condition, we have two options. If any content contains any specific keyword or pattern, our second option is if content is shared from Microsoft 365. Suppose you're not concerned about the content, you're concerned about if somebody is sharing data outside. In that case, you can go for simple plain option, the second one. Or if you're interested that I am willing to target my DLP for sensitive informations, you should go for content contains. Here, if you click on add, this gives you two options. Would like to add your own sensitive information types or would like to add trainable classifiers. Just for understanding, sensitive informations are the patterns that we match. Trainable classifiers are kind of common kind of keywords that we see in any kind of documents and data. For example, a bank document can contain many different kind of common keywords like bank account number, IFSC code, or transaction, credit card, debit card. These are different keywords. These are coming under trainable classifiers. Sensitive info type includes matched values like matching patterns, credit card pattern, 16 digit long, starting with 4 or something like this. So you have to decide which one is best fit for you. You can select that one. Let me go for sensitive info type here. And notice I have 324 items here. I can select all. And I can create my policy. But it's up to you which one is best suitable for you. For example, I'm looking for credit card. And here, I'm going to select credit card, add. You can add more based on your requirements. For example, the next thing is I'm going to add here, maybe passport number. I'm looking for example, US UK passport number pattern I want to match. So I can add in this way, and I can add more conditions if you like to. You can see I'm happy with this option. So my condition is fulfilled. I don't need to add anything else. Now what I want to take under action, if these matching patterns we have, I'll go for this option we have listed. Restrict access or encrypt the content in Microsoft 365 locations. Option is block users from receiving email or accessing SharePoint, OneDrive, Teams file, and also the Power BI if you have selected the scope. Default configuration is block only people outside your organization, not the inside user. Inside user will be able to basically access the information. If you're going to share information between internal user as well, this will be possible. But block everyone means you're going to include internal and external both. In my GDPR policy that I was testing, I have block everyone option. So it doesn't matter you are going to share TIN number to your internal user, this is blocking it. So we can go for block everyone here if you like to, or only for external. Whenever you perform any external sharing activity, then only this option will be trying to do something else. Block everyone is going to block internal and external both. This is very simple. Action is okay. Next, user notification. How you want to notify users? By default, this is off in this policy. I need to switch on. And then after I can decide if I want to notify my users in Office 365 services with a policy or mail tips. You know, you get email tip. Email tip is information that if you're going to use Outlook or you're going to use any kind of Word, Excel, PowerPoint, if you want to enable mail tip there as well. So as soon as you're going to add any kind of sensitive information while composing messages, emails, then you will get the mail tip there that this message conflicts with organization policy, something like this. So user will be notified. Who will be notified? Notify the user who sent, shared, or last modified the content. Then if you have something required, like for example, you want to notify other people as well, so I can go for this option. Apart from the person who is sending or sharing the modified content, I want to inform my owner of the SharePoint, OneDrive, owner of the SharePoint and OneDrive content. And also, I want to add some more. For example, Alan is security head, and Alan wants to get notified for all these kind of matching patterns. So I can go for searching for Alan. And let me select Alan here. You can see Alan's ID is already added in this. So you can notify to this person as well, apart from these guys. Are you going to attach matching email messages to the notification? Any exchange emails, the message will be attached in the notification that something has been matched in DLP. By default, system already sends you the customized policy, but if you want to change it, you can customize in your own language as well. So this option we have. Also, show the policy tip as dialogue for the end user before send in Exchange workload. Before sending this, you can say it. So you can enable this option as well, or you can upload any kind of JSON file, a code, as a kind of pop-up dialog box. So that all things you can modify here if you have these kind of requirements. So policy tips are a lot of things. If you can configure, if you can customize, you can go for it. Else, leave to the system. System will generate mail tips automatically and send are present to you while sending the email, especially for the Exchange workloads. In case if you want to say, okay, I want to provide a kind of compliance URL KB article page where user will be clicking on and they can see what kind of settings we have, what kind of permissions we have, why I'm not able to send this message. So you can add here kind of a URL in case if you want to provide some information. So notification is okay. I'm happy with user notifications. The next is override. Override is a very good thing. Now, if I enable here, what happens? I can give override tab. You notice when I was sending the email message, it was sending me the, it was giving me a kind of email tip. Along with the email tip in SharePoint, in OneDrive, in Teams, this can give you an override tab. An override tab will be available there. You can click on that. You can give business justification. And then after you will be able to perform the activity, sending the message, sharing the message. But your override activity will be recorded. And maybe if your business justification is not enough to justify your security backend team, they can call you for the more clarification. So override is good. Maybe for if you have proper business justification, you can go with this option. So I can enable this. I need business justification to override. Next is override the rule automatically if they report it as a false positive. Apart from override tab, I can give report tab as well. Report tab is something where user thinks that maybe system is detecting the pattern wrong. Maybe I'm not sending any sensitive information, but I'm sending a kind of common information. Just for example, I was sending 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 FA, and it was detecting TIN number. Maybe this is my house number. Maybe this is my some kind of different number. And because of the pattern, DLP is detecting it as a kind of false positive. In that case, I can give report option. In report, what happens? Report will add entry in backend system where admin can see that user has reported this is a false positive. And based on that, admin can maybe tune the policy once again, why this is detecting the false positives. So along with override, I can give report tab as well. But keep in mind, just only clicking the report tab will not give you the override option. You have to click on override specifically, then only you will be able to perform the activity. Report means you're just only adding the information log related to your information, related to your thinking in the system. So admins can check if the DLP policy should be modified or tuned. The next is require the end user to explicitly acknowledge the override. Yeah, definitely. You have to explicitly acknowledge the override in case of if you want to send the messages. So different options we have. Most of the organization, they're happy with this. Override. And if there's any proper business certification, they go for this option here. Next is incident report. This is very important. Apart from the sender who is sending or trying to share the message or information, I want to send incident report related to each and every DLP activity to my admins, to my organization users with lots of information. The DLP match, what was the DLP confidence, means low confidence, high confidence, what percentage was there, like DLP can give you that I was 100% accurate on this. This was a kind of matching pattern. So lots of things comes under incident report. So by default, admins get alert here, but I can add more people here. And I can configure if I want to send the DLP report every time, or I can set the frequency. Like include instance more than or equals to 15, then only send the alert. Or volume when it's more than 10 MB or 20 MB, then only send the alert. During 60 minutes, during last 30 minutes, or maybe for next 2 hours. So different kind of options we have. And if you want to see the report only for a specific user, you can go here, or this will be sending report for all the users. So you can configure how you want to get the alert frequency. Also use email incident report to notify you when a policy match occurs. So you can enable it here. By default, site admins will get all the notifications, and you can add more people here for the incident. Along with this, you can decide here inside the incident what information should be included. Person name, sensor info information, rules and severity label, the content that match the rule, including the surrounding text. Lots of things will be included. If you are not interested to see some, you can remove. So these options are there. If you are interested in this, you can enable or disable in this way. And I'm good with this. So send information to the people, like especially to admins when rule matches. But you can decide if you want to change the incident report information or the different kind of information you want to add in this. Last is additional options. Additional options is basically for, we can create many rules. Inside a single DLP policy, I can create 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 rules for different kind of matching patterns. For example, I want whenever credit card is there, block the user, block the sharing. But when I have any kind of account number, then don't block the user, but only block when they are performing the activity, sharing the data to outside. We cannot combine these two situations in a single rule. In that case, I should go for multiple rules. So for these situations, if I enable this, it says if there is a match of this rule, don't go for the another rule to check. Because in case of multiple rules, there may be a conflict. Maybe there would be possibilities. So you can decide if you want to check all the rules and go for the least privilege or least access, or you want to stop the rule. Once a single rule is matched, don't go for other rule processing. So these kind of options you can use. And you can also enable this option, evaluate my rule on per component. Means, especially for email, not only analyze my body of the message, but also analyze the content inside the attachments as well. If you're not enable this, what happens? System will only analyze if you're going to add any information directly available inside the message, the body of the message, not the attachments. So this is basically go for the enhanced control in DLP. And for the rules, you can set the priority. By default, it's a first policy. That's why we have zero priority. We have no other option. But if you go for multiple policy creations in this, multiple rule creations in this, you will have multiple different kind of priority available in this here. So I'm happy with this, and I'm going to probably save it. Okay, definitely. This is something we need to configure Exchange and Teams. So specifically, you have to configure Exchange and Teams, not for other locations. Like OneDrive and SharePoint is not compatible with this. So we need to remove this, or let me remove this checkbox here. Click on save. Now this is going to save this rule. And now good thing is, when you're going to create this rule, after this, this will ask you how you want to enable the policy. You have three options. Run the policy in simulation mode. You can turn on simulation mode. This will not block anything. but this will be generating the logs and information. You can also enable show policy tip in this. And also we have option turn the policy on if not edited within next 15 days. So in 15 days, you're not going to edit this policy, policy will be automatically turned on. Or turn the policy on immediately or leave this policy off. Maybe you want to activate it in a change window somewhere in later in future. You want to create multiple policies and you want to create this all, you want to enable these all policy in a change window, then you can keep the policy off. So I can turn on this policy immediately, click next and submit. Now this policy may take up to 24 hours when you can test it. You cannot test any DLP policy immediately just after the creation. That's why I demonstrated how any existing policy looks like GDPR policy, and it was blocking my messages, blocking my TIN number almost everywhere without any challenge. So if you're going to perform this activity, maybe in test environment somewhere in your organization, you should wait at least up to 24 hours when you are going to test DLP policy, because before this time, this may give you unexpected results. So policies here, and yeah, policies here, this will be available here, maybe just in 24 hours, and then after you can test it, because these policies are already there. That's why I was able to test and seeing the expected results. So this is something that what we have in DLP. And if I go back to my slides here, so how to create custom DLP policy, we have already seen. We have to go for these different stages, like go to the Purview portal, create policy, go to select templates, then select locations, configure rule, configure condition, actions, and notifications options, and you can create a policy. These all stages we have to follow. We have seen all these stages in demonstrations, how these templates looks like. You can see enhanced, financial. If you want to combine multiple together, you can go for custom that we are all discussing about. Especially when you go for rule, in rule we configure conditions, what we want to do with this, exception, what kind of sensitive info type you want to add here, what actions you want to take, you want to block everyone, you want to block people only outside the organization, override configurations, notification configurations, these all things we have available in six different kind of categories. You can enable your rule, this is specifically the policy in simulation mode. And in simulation mode, you have options for if you want to enable the policy in next 15 days, if this is not modified, you can select that option as well. Or you can turn on the policy immediately if you like to. Now, one more thing I would like to add here, that DLP is now coming with extension options. You can add Chrome and Firefox extension. We have Purview extension. This can bring DLP policy to your browser as well. In browser, if you're going to send or share any kind of sensitive info, and if this extension is already installed in Chrome and Firefox, so this can sync what DLP policy you have created in your account in your Microsoft 365, and this can prevent data sharing in these kind of browsers as well. But definitely you have to think about how you are going to install this extension. You want to give this access to the user, or you want to use any centralized deployment model like SSCM or any kind of other software distribution options to distribute these kind of extensions to your users' browsers. So, browsers are, very simple place where you can share sensitive information. So I can block my sensitive information data to these places as well using this extension option. So this is actually very helpful. Now, in the last, because you are not going to see any kind of lab scenario here, I would like to give you this guided demonstration link. This link will help you to go for a video guided environment where you can see how to create DLP policy, how to use it. So I'm going to paste this link in chat window, and you can keep it safe. And later, if you want to go for it, you can click on this. This will open a guided video where you can see how to create policy step by step. So there you need to click next or click on the prompt on the screen, and you will be able to see how to configure the policies. So this is something what I have planned for this webinar. I would say thank you so much for joining. And if you want to get some more information related to these different kind of trainings, related to security and compliance, and also related to Microsoft 365, don't hesitate to talk to us. You can go to coinix-solutions.com website. There you have chat option. You can connect with our human kind of sales representative there, and they can help you selecting a better course or for more understanding in this. So don't hesitate to connect with us. And also, I'm going to add the guided demonstration link in chat. I believe this time you will have a feedback link as well. So please let us know how was your experience here in this webinar. And if you are interested for such kind of more future webinars, let us know. I'm still here for next half an hour to answer your questions. If you have any query and question related to this webinar, let me know in chat window and I'll be very happy to answer all these. So just give me a quick minute. I'm sending the guided demo link, that what we generally use in this demonstration. All right, so you can see this guided demo link in chat window. Please use it, and you can see what we have in DLP custom policy creation. It's a very good one, actually. So guys, thank you so much for joining, and please don't hesitate to ask your questions in chat. I'm going to answer all these here. Thank you. And if you're leaving, so thank you so much for joining once again. Enjoy your day. Bye-bye.